approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do."
Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing, "To the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen."
Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep."
Before I begin the sermon proper, I always like to take an opportunity to say just a few personal words to the congregation. And I want to say, since this is my first visit with you all, Pat and I are so pleased to be with you on this day, this third Sunday of Easter. And I told some of the congregation earlier in Cleola that I'm not sure if it took me 5 minutes or 6 minutes to get here from my house, but it didn't take very long. And I drove slow on the access road. And so it's a joy to be with you all here and to be a part of this community. And I want to also say how pleased I am to serve with your priest at the altar. You're blessed and you're lucky to have her, and she's a good priest and a pastor to you all. And I also want to say and remind you that the churches in the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth hold you all up in prayer, as I hope and pray you hold them up in prayer as we continue to move forward in ministry and mission. Now, when I looked at this lesson and thought about it, I was really tempted to tell you some fishing stories about my fishing at night, because this story was about the end of a night fishing experience or adventure for the fishermen. They were trying to make a living, but I decided not to, because then I would have to show you pictures. But when we look at the 21st chapter of John, most scholars believe this was and y'all probably have heard this and know this, this was an add-on chapter to the gospel, because in the 20th chapter it really ends the gospel of John. But then we have this wonderful story, and in a general sense, chapter 21 points to the future life of the disciples. It tells them what they were going to do, but what to expect. In our reading this morning, two stories about Jesus appear as the disciples are gathered on the Sea of Galilee. In that section that we just heard, they're just basically two parts, I think. Jesus, he talks to them about the fish and about that, and then he talks about to Peter, which is a little bit different than the first part. And as you all have heard again from the clergy that you've experienced, in the Gospel of John, there are always at least two meanings. There's the superficial meaning of the facts. Jesus appeared on the seashore, and you know that's a story, but underneath that, there's a second meaning. So there's always at least two meanings to John's stories. First, let's look at the first part of our reading. And Jesus is standing there, and it's early in the morning, and like a lot of early mornings before the sun comes up, it could be a little hazy. They may or may not have been able to see who he was, but there was this man that said, have you caught anything? Well, no, we haven't caught anything. We fished all night. And they were a little bit offshore. And Jesus tells them to throw on the other side. And they're probably saying, well, who is this guy? He hasn't been out here with us all night. But Jesus may have seen something that they hadn't seen. That you often are able to see when you're a distance from the fisher or the fish. And so they experience this person. But the reason that we have this story that's tacked on to the 20th chapter is that Jesus did indeed rise from the dead. He is alive. He is real. He tells them, come, let's talk. Let's eat together. Let's drink together. Come and feel me. Let's have a conversation. The reason for that story is to prove once and for all that he wasn't a ghost. He wasn't kind of a spirit. He was a real person. For the early church, they needed to hear that because there were lots of stories about, that you're just seeing an image. Earlier in John's gospel, the tomb is empty. And the disciples said, I'm not sure we believe that, this is an occasion where Jesus comes to his disciples and he is there in the flesh to prove once and for all to those disciples and those people with them that he was in fact alive. He had come back from the dead. So the aim of this first part of the 21st chapter is simply to be quite clear of the truth, the concreteness of the resurrection. Jesus indeed had conquered death as he said he would. And it is as though he is saying again, here I am, touch me, listen to me. I'm not a ghost, I'm not a spirit. It is I. Well, in that first part, we have this very intriguing part about the net and the catching of the fish. And the first time I read that, whenever that was, I was almost going to say in seminary, but surely I read that before I was in seminary. It was very specific, 153 fish. Why the number? Well, over the centuries, especially in the ancient church, different writers, different theologians had all these intricate explanations of the 153. And they're fascinating. I think one of the ones that I'm trying to remember who it was, it may have been Augustine, that said that there were 153 species of fish in the sea. They could identify at that time. So the point was that all of the fish that were there were in that net. So every fish was caught. And of course, the point, I think, the secondary meaning is that all of God's children are to be in that net, in the church. That net went out and caught all kinds of people. When you think of the different kinds of people in our world, all of those are part of God's church, or can be, or should be. Many of us think of, or at least I have to confess that when I was growing up in Houston and St. Mark's Church in west part of Houston, I thought all Episcopalians in the world were just like we were, and they worshiped just like we did. And the great shock of my life was when I went to college my first year at TCU and went to church at Trinity and found they were doing some things there that I had never seen or heard. They did that, and I thought, what was that? And then during the consecration, somebody built a fire around the altar. There was smoke everywhere. Well, that shattered my view of the church, but in a good way. So the 153 represent all kinds of people, all sorts of men, women, children, young people. But then there's another part about the story, I think, it's stated in the gospel. Having fished a good bit of my life, I have done a lot of fishing with a cast net or a seine. And I remember one time I was down at Freeport with my father, and I had an old cast net, and I threw it out, and there were a whole lot of fish. You could just see them. They were teeming. And I caught them in the net, and I started bringing them in, and the net was rotten, and it started breaking. So by the time I got the net in, most of the fish had escaped. So the point of this story, I think, it's so wonderful, is that the net, the church, if you can follow that or believe that kind of imagery, is so strong and so faithful and so good and so encompassing that those in that net, regardless of all of the sizes and whatever these fish are, won't break that net. The net, the church, will hold all sorts and conditions of people. I mean, the net, the church, is so strong and it's so good that you can even have Democrats and Republicans. I mean, far left and far right. And one of the wonderful things about the church here is you've got a clock up on the wall. And so I know what I'm up against. Now the last section of the gospel, where Jesus confronts Peter and asks him about his love. Do you love me, Peter? And he does it three times. And is that not reminiscent to Peter's denial three times? And I also believe in that he didn't ask that in a confronting way. Peter, do you love me? No. Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? And he was, in a way, that was a forgiving kind of way of asking him. Sure, he knew Peter loved him, but he was doing it in a forgiving way, because remember last week's gospel, that was about forgiveness. Jesus comes and stands among them and said, peace be with you. But he was really forgiving those disciples for their abandonment of him. And so one of the gospel messages in John last Sunday and this Sunday is about forgiveness, about Jesus' forgiveness of Peter. So, my sisters and brothers in Christ, this extra chapter of John is there for us also. Yes, Jesus did rise from the dead and appeared to a number of people, and for sure his disciples. And they had a meal together. And like last week, as I said, the gospel lesson, Jesus is forgiving of his disciples for their abandonment, their failure, their weakness in time of trial and turmoil. He is big enough and compassionate enough to forgive them and also to help them get ready for what they were going to be called on to do. But Jesus is big enough and compassionate enough to forgive us and accept us for our failures and our sins. And like those early disciples, we too must do likewise throughout our life. He taught us that prayer we call the Lord's Prayer. And in that, we are to forgive those who have sinned against us. And let us not forget the image of the full net, drug ashore with all of those fish. Jesus' church and our church is big enough to hold, to include all of God's children. Amen. Let's join together as we say, Almighty and ever-living God,
we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son, and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
And now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen.